You want all real.
You have you to complete, and there is no deal.
There's a midget standing tall, and the giant beside him about to fall.
This is the Tanya Free and Friends Talk Show, your destination for social and political straight talk, on air, online, and on point. Get ready to join the conversation with your host, Ms. Tanya Free.
Today is Wednesday, July 1st. Welcome to the Tanya Free and Friends Talk Show. I am Tanya Free, joined by my wonderful friends, Jeff Charity. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Well, thank you for being here. I'm doing well. And also with me is Gilbert Wilkerson. How are you?
Hi, Tanya. Good to be here.
Well, thank you all for being here. And sitting at the social media desk is Antoinette Baylor. Hey. And working behind the scenes is Marcus Evans and Mr. Free and Jeremiah when he comes in. Thank you all for being here today. We want our listeners to join a conversation. Phone lines are open 804-321-1010 or 844-321-1010, or you text us at Tanya Free 63975 to weigh in on the conversation. Let's get started talking about the Confederate flag, which has been front and center. The death of 9 people killed in a historic black church in Charleston, South Carolina has sparked discussion about the removal of the Confederate flag from South Carolina state capitol. Also, too, Georgia, Mississippi, Alabama, and Tennessee and Virginia are having discussions as well about the flag and other Confederate symbols on other official state items as well on state property. In a special session, South Carolina state legislators would take up the matter next week. Reportedly, they have the 2/3 vote they need in order to remove the flag. Jeff, let me ask you, what do you think? Do you think they will really remove the flag, or do you think it's just talk?
No, there seems to be, the flag, in my opinion, will eventually be removed from the Capitol. There's great groundswell of support. Although there are protests on the adverse side of that issue, I think that eventually, from initial standpoint there, they do seem to have the support to be able to get the votes to get it removed eventually. So.
Okay, so you think next week it will come down?
Next week possibly,
if
they can get to it that fast, then.
Well, it's long overdue. I mean, we had a young lady last week over the weekend that climbed a pole and took it down.
Yes, ma'am.
So, I mean, it's time. It's well, it's past due.
I would agree with that.
Yeah, well, Alabama, the governor there, by executive order, they had 4 flags. When I heard they had 4 flags, and he had all of them taken down, which was.
Sure. Decisive, quick action, I think, like you said, it's past time.
Oh, so. Yeah, past overdue. And the governor, now, they are having a little debate in Mississippi and Tennessee.
Yes.
They're talking about redesigning the flag opposed to taking it down. What do you think about that, Gilbert?
Oh, gosh. You know, let me take you back on the flag. My thought is... I think the flag should be flying on state property, number one.
You do?
I do not.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But one other thing is that my question is always, if we took the flag down, how would black America be better? If we took that flag down, how is it helping? We said Black Lives Matter.
Right.
Okay, we take that flag down, are black America better? If we redesign the flag and put another one up, is it better? We went to talk about 9 people getting killed in South Carolina. We ended up on a flag. You know, it's always about some other issue than what the real issue is 9 people were murdered. Was it because of the flag? Or was it somebody that had a flag and that was just generally crazy?
Well, I think it's a start. It's a start for the mere fact that the person that committed these murders used that as a symbol. That's what, you know, he was in, on his Facebook page. And that's a start for the mere fact that why would a state put up something that is painful and remind us of our history that was unconstitutional.
Yeah. Oh, I agree on that.
Why,
yeah.
So start there. Why would you want a symbol of something of that nature flying in a state that's supposed to be united for all people? Right. There should be only one flag, that's the United States flag. Start there first. Right. But when you have people that feel that it should be flying on state property, that's a problem right there.
Yeah,
that's why I said starting with the flag, and being that this young man used this as his symbol for what he was doing, you know, a symbol of hate, and he carrying out that mission to start a race riot. That's, like I said, that's a start for the mere fact that we got to start somewhere.
Well, yeah, I agree. I mean, I shouldn't.
Because we couldn't come to the table. We wouldn't be at the table right now had it not been for the death of those 9 people.
Yeah.
And, you know, and his mission to incite a race riot.
Yeah.
And that's what it is a symbol of.
Mm-hmm. I see another problem that we're trying to do this. More people have purchased a flag than ever.
Right.
You know, and I'm trying to see the whole elephant here. You know, we look at one side of the elephant, we see that side, but what's the whole elephant look like? And when we look at the broad picture, is that more people are divided because of it, in a sense. I'm a hold my ground.
to terrorist flags. And I don't see what's so hard to understand on any side of the argument. Well, let's say that you are one of those Confederate flag terrorist symbol supporters out there. Now, you are screaming about Obamacare, which y'all call it. It's really the Affordable Care
Act. Right, it is. But he's calling it now Obamacare, so I've heard the president say that.
Oh, he has called it that. Okay, well, if he want to own it, he can own it. You're mad about Obamacare, and you're saying that the government should not have the right to force you to buy health insurance, right? Mm-hmm. That's what they're saying. That's the primary argument, right? So then flip that argument to this Confederate flag, these monuments and stuff. What right do these people here in Gaston County have to make my family pay property taxes that's going towards supporting this Confederate monument in front of our courthouse and also at one of our voting poll stations? Isn't that the same thing?
That's a good point. Mm-hmm. That's a good
You're
point.
You're forcing me. And then I'll leave you with this. Two things. Police officers, cops that's out there, you know, gunning down unarmed black people and white people as well. They're gunning down a whole lot of people. We shouldn't make that a racial issue. We should make that as a justice injustice issue. But they ain't running around with Confederate flags. We know that mass incarceration is racist based, right? So these prisons ain't got the Confederate flag up there. So we don't need symbols to remind us that racism exists in this country. We have the racists themselves to be those living examples of racism for us. In terms of these white people around here, and I really don't see the Confederate flag anymore like I did in the 80s, but I did see one truck with one flag. That's his right. That's his private property.
Right, and I, you know what? I don't have any problem. They put it on their private property. That's fine. That's I don't care about that. Right. But on any state and federal property, I have a real issue. Like you said, our tax dollars going towards that.
Exactly.
And one last point, if I may. Society, people, ask yourself. Like, I understand that the monument of Christopher Columbus in Boston has been vandalized. And I asked people, did you know Christopher Columbus, besides being a genocidal maniac, was a pedophile? And that he also served time, I think it was the Vatican, when they read his journals and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He served prison time for his crimes against the indigenous people he came across when he was lost.
Okay.
So people, think about what you are telling our children. See, this isn't the reason racism still exists, but it plays a role in it, because we are telling children that racists, enslavers, genocidal maniacs who stole land, and also, you know, were rapists. I mean, these are the most vile individuals.
Okay, Scott, let's do this. Let's take one issue at a time. Okay, let's.
I mean, it's the same thing, though. Do you see what I'm saying?
I understand exactly what you're saying, but we got to take it slow, take it one at a time. So tell everybody to listen to your show.
Tune in tonight to New Abolitionist Radio so you can find out, and I hope you Confederate supporters will chime in with us. So that we can tell you the South really didn't lose the war. They, you know, it was a draw, because now all the states and corporations and the federal government can practice slavery. So that's New Abolitionist Radio, 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time, Black Talk Radio Network.
We're going to be listening to that. Thank you, Scott. We appreciate that.
You know,
you're welcome.
My question is, what's the purpose of having it up on the Capitol?
Right.
I mean,
it's a good question.
It comes up to why you got it up there.
Sure.
If the war has been won and life has changed and everybody partaking of the government, you got one whole government, a unity of people we're trying to build, and we're not trying to go back. I can understand.
Well, I think
not having it up there.
Let me go back. I take that back. White supremacy. That's what that flag is flying up there for, and is in the
Some
South.
People disagree with you and say it's just what do you call it? History. I don't want that history, but I'm just saying that's what some people's argument is.
Like the president said, why would we endorse slavery?
I agree.
That it was okay. Why would we endorse that? We go to the phone, Earl from Richmond. How are you, Earl?
I'm doing just great. I'm enjoying the dialogue, and it's funny because we keep hollering about us and that Confederate flag, and it's not really us and that Confederate flag, nor was it us and that Constitution. It was always written before us. It was written by white folks. And what I see happening, and I hope y'all can elaborate on this, is this. We as African Americans can get in that conversation, it don't mean jack, because they feel the way that they feel. The conversation is between the white folks, those that feel that it's heritage and pride, versus those that saying it's, you know, the KKK. That's where this is going to get resolved, because all we do when we get in it, as y'all know, is put fuel to the fire and distract it. When I hear the KKK picking up the flag and going to walk down South Carolina, where's the white folks that say it's supposed to be fired? You see, mm-hmm. we don't need to get in that. That's just my opinion. You know, black folks, we're going to do what we're going to do. But think about this. They're the ones that got to fight this out and rationalize and then accept the history, the American history that white America, should we say, perpetrated on them. Their ignorance, and that's what's happening. Think about it. These white folks are still telling you it's about heritage.
Right, and I think we're at the point that we're not buying that now, Earl.
Right.
We're at the point we're not buying it now, and we've already said the flag and the heritage and all that belongs in a museum.
Right, and see, we're all on that same page. Them white folks, is the businesses now that's doing their stuff, those are the ones that's making white America now face the truth about their history. Because they've never received it from us. They've always dismissed us. But they got some serious problems now, as you know, with Donald Trump and everything that's happened. All of this bigotry, all of this, oh no, we're not racist, and the conversations inside the house. All this stuff has come out into the community. And that's where we're at now. We're rewriting that Constitution. Now, once they finish their fight over whether it's heritage or whether it's slavery, then we can go back and address economic empowerment, all of the governmental things that's been holding us back. That's where we're going. But that fight, Confederate flag, that's a white-on-white conversation, because they got to define what they really thought that flag stood for, because us saying what it is, they dismiss it. It's them white ones that got to do it. And when they define it, they finally realize that it was hate. That's why it's going to come down.
I think they got it. And once it comes down in South Carolina and other places in Virginia, that we are now will not be issuing a Confederate flag license plates. You got some places that have it. I think the places, the states that are going to redesign the flag is where we have to continue to fight and let them realize what the real history is.
And we have to get strong leaders now that represent us, that voices the opinion of what we need, and not just corporate America. And I think we're on the right page. But us getting into this, it's them white folks got to deal with that flag, man.
Well, I think corporate America helped a whole lot. When you started talking money, dollars and cents, that gets people's attention. You know. Thank you, Earl. We got to go to break.
Take care. Stay back.
Okay, you too now. We'll be right back.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Cynthia Hurd found that grace. Susie Jackson found that grace. Ethel Lance found that grace. The Payne Middleton doctor found that grace. Iwanza Sanders found that grace. Daniel L. Simmons Sr. found that grace. Sharonda Coleman Singleton found that grace. Myra Thompson found that grace. Through the example of their lives, they've now passed it on to us. May we find ourselves worthy of that precious and extraordinary gift.
as long as our lives endure.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
May grace now lead them home. May God continue to shed his grace on the United States of America.
Hi, this is your buddy Chocolate Chip, and you've heard me talking about crowdfunding over the past couple of weeks. Did you know that over $15 billion has been given to help people get money to pay bills, start a business, or fund a charity? This is not a loan, and no repayment is required. We had a great response last time, and so this time we are having two workshops. Yes, two workshops at 1420 Hall Street, Suite D in Richmond, Monday, July 6th at 12 noon, and again at 6 p.m. Call 804-647-8136 or 804-363-3385 to register and reserve your spot. Seating is limited. Call 804-363-3385 or 804-647-8136. That's Monday, July 6th. Two opportunities to make a change in your finances. Remember, this is not a loan and no repayment is required. Call today, 804-647-8136 and 804-363-3385. We had a great response last time, and so this time we are having two workshops. Yes, two workshops at 1420 Hall Street, Suite D in Richmond, Monday, July 6th at 12 noon and again at 6 p.m.
What is New Orleans Talk Network? It's today's hottest topics with an added flair. You. Get ready, because the conversation will be hot. And better yet, mobile. Download the New Orleans Talk Network app, available on Android, iPhone, iPad. And you can listen to us on the web at www.neworleanstalknetwork.com. Write down our talk line at 504-341-TALK. That's 504-341-8255. Interactive and worldwide. That's what we are. Join in on the real conversation and tell a friend about the New Orleans Talk Network.
Conversation. Phone lines are open right now. Give Tanya a call at 804-321-1010 in Central Virginia and 844-321-1010 toll free coast to coast. That's toll free 844-321-1010.
I want to welcome to the panel former Richmond Councilman Marty Jewell. How are you, friend?
I'm fine. Thanks for having me today.
Well, thank you for being here. And also with us is Pete Chavis. How are you?
Fantastic.
Good. Thank you so much for being here. I want to get you all's opinion as to what you think about this Confederate flag, and do you really think it's going to come down in South Carolina? They're holding a special session next week, and supposedly they have the two-thirds vote they need for it to come down. Marty, you think it's all talk, or do you think it will really come down?
That's hard to say. Opinions are flying 180 degrees. The fact is, though, that I don't want to get trapped in the wrong narrative. Yes, we do need to take these symbols down. Yes, we need to get rid of that flag. But we really need is a truth and reconciliation movement. that flag symbolizes more lies than truth. Mm-hmm. That was the Northern Virginia Army battle flag, headed up by Robert E. Lee. It was never
Scott, the just talking
flag
about that.
Of the Confederacy. Mm-hmm. But because they have but malevolent forces have misappropriated the flag, they have done so to stick it in our face that it is a sign of defiance.
Right.
And go to hell. That's what that means.
Right, white supremacy. That's basically what it is. Let me go to the phones right quick.
White supremacy, sure. Right.
Reggie, how are you, friend, from Richmond?
Hey, how you doing, Tanya?
Good, how about you?
Well, as we expected, I didn't have a good time at the Jazz Festival this past weekend. Happened. I was thinking about you guys
okay.
at the Jazz Festival.
Thank you so much.
But my whole thing that we're going to need some deacons for defensive justice for these churches. 7 to 8 churches burnt.
Yeah, I heard that this morning.
And the only thing that these police officers say, well, it might be some kids involved. Well, again, I'm looking from the historical point of view that every time when white folks, when Europeans are told what to do, they get angry and say, you're not going to tell me anything. I'm going to do what I want to do, case in point.
Defiance.
Swastika, known as that flag. And I just got to say, that young lady in South Carolina, I'm praying for her. Because for her to put her life online, I was afraid she was getting shot in the head climbing that pole.
Yeah, her name is Bree Newsom, I think it is.
Yeah, yeah, and I say we better protect her because I've seen too many times where activists from the Black Panthers, and I'm sure your panelists know this, many people are locked up today for trumped up charges because they want to be revolutionary. Well, again, this young lady took a stand.
She really
but
did.
Again, I'm hoping that the same people will support her. But I'm going to break some news on your show real quick.
Okay.
That a friend of mine who's a White House correspondent,
mm-hmm.
and unfortunately he works for a Fox affiliation. Oh, and shout out to Macy Mason for telling Donald Trump to take a hike.
I know. He's lost 3 businesses so far.
But they say that President Obama with this, what, the Promise Keeper Initiative,
mm-hmm.
well, I've been told that in January, that President Obama, the last year during the election, is going to start rolling out programs which are going to try to start entrepreneurship in the inner city. Now, my thing is that, yeah, that's nice, but that's, in my opinion, 3 years too late. I mean, but better late than never.
Yeah, that's the way I see it, better late than never.
Yeah, but I've been told that in January, that's when the White House, they have not made anything official yet.
Okay.
But I've been told that's what they're going to kick off, so I'm going to break news.
I know you, Reggie, you will hold him to it. If he doesn't do it, I know you will personally hold him to it. You'll write him a letter or something.
Well, you know how I feel about Hillary. Like I know, said, anybody but Hillary.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not supporting her at all.
We were having that conversation before the show started, so.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah,
we'll see. Role. Bernie Sanders is gaining a little bit of ground, so you never know.
Nobody knew about President Obama when he was President Obama when he came in campaign Tim Kaine and look what happened then.
That is so true. Tell everybody when you listen to your show.
Yeah, every Saturday from 11:45 to 1, we're going to have people from Metropolitan Baseball Lily. They're trying to raise money to go to Florida.
Okay.
And we had Monet Davis a couple of weeks ago.
Right.
I had a chance to talk to her and some other things we're working on. Also, we're trying to work on some of the old Black high schools of Armstrong High School and Booker T. If you missed last week's show, we had a young man that's trying to get a museum and trying to get some information together to honor our old veterans of the old Black schools.
Okay,
so
super.
That's a project we're working on.
Okay.
Reggie.
Thank you, Reggie. Go ahead. Marty has a question.
If I might, Bill Forrester gave me a call not long ago. He's looking for board members for Metro Junior Baseball League. It's a wonderful program. It is a national program that's almost 50 years old. Mm-hmm. They've had their tournament, their Black World Series tournament in Richmond for the last 2 years, and nobody knows anything about it. We don't support our own, and so maybe if we can, if there's anybody out there listening, give me a call. My number is 585-8698, who would join up and make a huge contribution of time and commitment to that board.
Okay, super.
Metro Junior Baseball League.
Thank you. Thank you, Reggie. We'll talk to you soon.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And we're going to go to the phones for Rare Brother in L.A. Hello, Rare Brother. How are you?
Oh, good. I'm good. Thank you for having me on the line. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, good, good, good. I don't know what's up with these brothers being 50 years late on Obama. What is that net talking about? 3 years too late. You guys don't understand. First, you got to get elected. Now, if you tell everybody that you're going to crush the white people and end the myth of white supremacy, are you going to get elected? If you tell everybody you're going to let everybody black out of prison, you're going to get elected? If you tell everybody you're going to let all the Mexicans come in from the border and give amnesty to everybody that's Mexican, are you going to get elected?
Okay, real brother, we got what you're saying, and I know, as far as the Confederate flag goes, you're going to say white supremacy 100%. I know
no,
you're going
to. I'm going to say that white supremacy is a myth. You guys keep thinking white people are superior. They're not doing this because they're superior. They're doing this because Obama's running circles around them, and they feel that they can't kill him. He can't mess. He can't be impeached.
Oh, don't even say that.
You're not going to shame him. So now they've gone to Plan Z, and that means just straight killing people.
Well,
so
the flag has been up. The flag was up before he even got into office.
True. Right, but see, the flag didn't mean anything. Why? Because you guys all.
Oh no, that's that. No, it's always meant something to them.
You guys think they're superior. I knew they weren't superior. Obama knew they weren't superior. That's why he beat them by 10 million votes. So we knew they weren't superior. It was the 90% of black people who think they're superior. Who are thinking that Obama's too late, he didn't do anything, he didn't kill everybody white.
Well, brother, no, this has nothing to do with President Obama. The flag has been up, like I said, prior to President Obama being in office.
Right,
and it's a shame that we did not pursue having this flag taken down before the deaths of the nine people that were killed on July.
There have been other efforts.
Before the president was
right.
Black. You guys keep saying that. Well, the flag was up before the president was black. Well, yeah, but the president wasn't black. Before the president was black. Okay? So they're killing people because the president is black, not because the flag is up.
Okay.
Okay.
Anybody want to tackle Red Brother today? Because he's not hearing me.
I don't think
he's not listening.
No, I'm hearing you. I'm just saying you guys keep saying the same thing. How many people do they have to kill before you realize they're not superior?
Well, I think we all know that. I mean, it's just a phrase we use sometimes. You might.
Yeah. No, it's.
I mean, you're right in one way, but
it's the mind. I don't know whether anybody can talk as long as Real Brother's on the
show. I'm
Jesus
Christ. Wait a minute, Real Brother. Marty wants to say something. Real Brother, Marty wants to say something. Go ahead, Marty.
What was I getting ready to say?
The fact
is, we don't consider them superior. They consider themselves superior. Wait a minute. And the fact is, they have to believe that, or they have to come allow the truth to come crashing down on them.
That doesn't explain why you believe it.
Who said I believe it? Who said we believe it?
Right. Yeah, we don't believe that.
We don't believe that.
It's an accusation against us that you don't know us.
That's a myth.
Do you not know what you're saying?
Okay, Real Brother.
I don't know what you're
saying.
No, what are you saying?
What are you saying, Real Brother? We got it. What are you saying, Real Brother?
That's what you're saying.
What are we saying? I didn't catch it.
You keep saying that whites are superior, it's white supremacy. Do you know what the word means? It means whites are superior.
No, that's not. We said that's what they think by the flying of the flag.
Okay, yeah, that's just the label that's been placed on the mindset of the ideology. That's the, the theory.
So the brother, the question, brother, I got a question. Bro, I got a question for you. One simple question. Can you answer it? Do you think the flag should come down? That's the question.
I think that the flag.
That's a yes or no question. It's a yes or no question. Is do you think it should come down?
Is it easy?
Thank you, sir.
Somebody asking me, is it easy for?
I just asked you, what do you think it should come down? I think that's what question what Tanya was asking in the first place.
Yeah, that's where we started, Real Brother.
I don't think he can hear us when we're talking. I mean, when he's talking.
Right.
Can you hear us when you're talking, Real Brother?
Yeah, I can hear you saying white people are superior, and I'm trying to get you to realize.
None of us
talking
said
about
that.
The flag.
None of us said that, Real Brother.
We
none of us said,
you,
said
we
that.
We asked you a question about the flag.
How many of you call it the myth of white supremacy?
Oh, God, I'm not going to answer that because I thought we'd get us too far off.
Well, I'm not going to answer that because none of us call it the myth of white supremacy. We just call it white supremacy because we think whites are superior. You're saying what you think. How many of you think that you're saying something that you don't think?
No, real brother, you're way off track. Way off track. We don't think that. We are saying that's what those that want the Confederate flag to continue to fly think.
You're not going to be able to say
that. Okay, real brother. Tell everybody when this is to your show.
Yes.
All right, you can hear the truth weeknights between the hours of 6 to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Real Brother Radio Network.
Okay, we'll continue the conversation on your show. How about that?
That would be great, but you guys are afraid to call my show. Sure, I tell the truth on my show.
Okay, brother.
Thank you, Real Brother. Have a good one, Neil.
We're all speaking lies. All
right.
Yeah, we're going to go to Wendell Sauls from Richmond. Hi, Wendell. How are
hey,
you?
Wendell.
Hey, how you doing, Tanya? How you doing today? How you doing, panelists?
Everybody's hey, well.
How you doing?
Well,
Wendell.
All right. I just wanted to comment on this flag issue. First, I would like to say that I think that the flag should come down only in the public square, not on your personal vehicle, not on your personal home, not on your personal property, because I don't know you personally.
Right.
And then if I get to know you personally and you have that flag and I find out that you're a racist and you this, that, and the other, it's for that community to handle that themselves. So my personal belief is it shouldn't be in the public square because it's public, because the flag means different things to different people. So when you have it in the public square, now you're offending a whole group of people,
yeah.
Not just black people, but you're also offending white people.
Right.
That's right.
Now,
right.
Now, in the deep South, that people have a real big problem with black people supporting the flag. Well, in the deep South, that flag means, you got to remember, the flag means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. So in the deep South, for black people who support the flag, it's for their heritage only. And they feel that just because that flag was used as a battle flag for the Confederate Army, they don't feel that they should throw away their heritage and the symbol of their heritage. So that's why you have a lot of the hip-hop artists and a lot of the rap artists in the Deep South who wears the Confederate flag. It's not because they're supporting slavery. It's because they're supporting their heritage, where they're from in the Deep South.
Hold on a second, bro.
Yeah.
I'm troubled with your explanation because, in fact...
Wendell, can you hold on? We got to take a break, and Marta, let you finish your thought after that, okay? Right. We'll be right back.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
If you or someone you love suffers from drug addiction, now is the time to utilize your private health insurance PPO plan. If eligible, receive up to $30,000 or more in substance abuse benefits with low or no out-of-pocket cost. We are the National Treatment Network, the premier drug and alcohol treatment referral service operating 24/7. We help connect you with facilities nationwide that accepts PPO private health insurance for substance abuse. If you have PPO substance abuse coverage and you need immediate admittance to a medical detox or residential rehab treatment center, call us now. Call our live referral helpline today. The call is free. This program is not available to Medicare or Medicaid customers. Call 800-961-2730. 800-961-2730. 800-961-2730. 800-961-2730.
Hey there, Big John Trimble here. Thanks to Tanya for freeing up the time to allow me to talk about the Big John Trimble Show. Heard Monday through Friday mornings, 6 to 9, right here on WCLM Radio. Yes, sir, after 57 years, I'm still on the radio and 24/7 on BigJohnTrimble.com. It all originates from our backyard studio over here in Verona. We play a wide variety of requested music from Fats Domino, Chuck Berry, and Donna Washington to George Jones, George Strait, and Loretta Lynn, along with the trivia contest and over-the-fence chats with our listeners from across the Richmond area, across the USA, and sometimes foreign countries. The Big John Trimble Show. It's the most fun you'll ever have with your clothes on.
Hello, friend. I'm Theron K. Cal, a.k.a. The Real Brother, inviting you to join me for The Real Brother Radio Show, weekdays from 6 to 9 p.m. on TheRealBrotherRadioNetwork.com. And don't forget to like us on The Real Brother Radio Show Facebook page, The Real Brother Radio Show, because the truth has value.
Join the conversation. Phone lines are open right now. Give Tanya a call at 804-321-1010 in Central Virginia and 844-321-1010 toll free coast to coast. That's toll free, 844-321-1010.
Okay, we're going to go back. Wendell, you made a comment that had us all talking. You were saying in the Deep South there are blacks that still think the flag should be flying. And I know in Mississippi, they claim that a vast majority of the vote, they got a mass majority of vote that want to keep the flag flying. And that was disturbing to me for the mere fact that I'm like, there is no protest, movement of the NAACP or African Americans or something, you know, protesting against that. When they said the vast majority, I was just disturbed. Now, I don't know the percentage of African Americans in Mississippi. I need to look that up. But the fact that they said majority is still disturbing, and they're just thinking about removing the emblem. So do you know what part of the South were you speaking of?
I'm talking about Alabama, okay. Georgia, Tennessee.
Mississippi as well, I guess?
Yeah, Mississippi, the area, because I served with a lot of people, you know, and I did almost 18 years in the military. I served with a lot of people. This is not a brand new issue. This issue concerning the Confederate flag being talked about for decades.
Right.
And my point is, don't my point is not to have it flying in the public square.
Right.
Public square meaning your state houses.
State and federal property. Right. Your tax dollars and my tax dollars are paying. Right.
Yeah.
State, I agree.
State and federal property. See, but people don't really understand the history mm-hmm. of the Confederate flag. See, people think that the Confederate flag only meant that, you know, the Confederacy used that flag for slavery, which that's not even the reason why Lincoln went to war. He went to war because the Confederates wanted to have their own president. So they wanted to have a Confederate state, and they wanted their own president. So that's when Lincoln said that he went to war to preserve the Union. But the Confederate flag has always been a part of the Deep South. But so when they went to war, that's the flag that they used.
I beg to differ with you, my brother. The flag we're talking about is the Stars and Bars. That is the battle flag of the Army of Northern Virginia. Now there is a Confederate flag that has the red and the blue. But it is a mere patch in a sea of white. That's the Confederate flag. They chose not to put that in our face. They mm-hmm. chose to put the defiant stars and bars in our face, which has a different meaning to them. Mm-hmm. And that is that we are defiant. Now, I don't know where you're reading that a lot of black folk in the Deep South are celebrating the Confederate flag. I imagine there are a good 13 of them down there probably doing it, because you're going to find that many fools anywhere. But I can guarantee you, Mike Gallagher, just on his talk show earlier, quoted a poll where
are you getting your information from? Since you told me that you don't know where I'm getting my information from, where are you getting your information from?
I'm trying to tell you right now.
Okay.
That a poll was done in which 42% of Americans polled were in favor of the Confederate flag, and exactly 42% were opposed to it, split right down the middle. But that's all Americans. You poll black folk, and I guarantee you that's going to be a lopsided number. You poll Northerners against Southerners, and you're going to see a lopsided number. Don't get tricked by statistics.
Well, you saying statistics, sir, but you're telling me don't get tricked by statistics.
I'm telling you, I haven't seen the poll that you see.
You getting my point? You getting my point?
I haven't seen your poll. Where's your poll?
I didn't cite any polls, sir. You citing polls.
Well, where are you getting this notion that black folk are down there celebrating the Confederate flag?
Sir, didn't I just say that I spent almost 18 years in the military? I know a lot of people in the South. Most of my time in the military was done in the South, sir.
All right.
So I'm not talking about what I've heard. I mean, you know, what somebody has told me. No, I'm talking about what I have seen and the people that I know.
In your world.
And they support the Confederate flag, Wendell?
The people in your world.
I'm asking, because Wendell, are these people you said that support, African Americans that support the Confederate flag?
Yeah, because the flag represents different things to the people in the Deep South.
Wow.
It don't just represent slavery.
Well,
it doesn't.
And what age range are you speaking of, Wendell?
Well, I'm 39 years old.
Okay.
The part that might be correct, and I would agree with you, Wendell, is that there is a Southern heritage that people celebrate. I'm raised in the South, and I know the charm of the South. But that's quite different from a Confederate heritage. And we need to understand the difference. And sadly, we don't talk about it enough to parse those things out. And that's why we need a truth and reconciliation movement in this city to begin to have honest...
You are right. People don't know what the true Confederacy means and what that was doing... to the country.
Well, let me ask you this, Wendell. What does it mean to you?
You're right.
What does the flag mean to you?
To me, the flag is a symbol of slavery and those who fought so that slavery can remain in this country.
Correct.
Okay. To me, That's what that flag symbols.
Okay.
That's why I'm for taking it down out of the public square. But on people, personal property and homes and things, I can't say go there and remove it because I don't know you as a person.
Right, and we shouldn't. And I think we shouldn't. I mean, if it's on your personal property or whatever, I don't have a problem with that. I just have a problem with, like you said earlier, on state and federal property.
That's
what you do when put it in your house. And one of the things I would prefer for them to put it on their truck or the house. That lets me know who you are and where you are.
Mm-hmm.
What you represent.
Yeah. Like I said, and once you find out who that person, I mean, what kind of life they live or whatever, it's for that community to handle that.
I don't think the community needs to do anything, but I think this.
I said anybody can have the right to live anywhere.
Right.
But the community, if that is a problem for that family, it is on that community to say this is the type of community that we want to have. We're not going to shun you or hate you or anything like that, but we at the same time, we don't want you to show, your hatred towards anybody else in this community.
Right.
See, we can all live together in the same community, but if you have that type of position, then we just want to let you know, where we coming from, and we understand where you coming from, and we all still can live here in this same community together.
Yeah.
Well, my thing is, I don't think it may be for a short period of time where, those that feel the Confederate flag should be flying, that they want to label themselves on the truck, the car, or whatever for a short period of time, and I say that from the standpoint, they are going to get whiplash from both or isolated from both black and white, not just African-American, but you got a lot of white folks or Caucasians that do not believe in the Confederate flag. Yeah. And they're going to feel it both ways, especially if you have folks where they work, and they're not going to label themselves individually. They may stand out as a group, but individually, you're not going to have very many that I think will come out like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's why
when I say community, I didn't say a color, I didn't say a culture, I didn't say an ethnic, group. I say a community.
Yeah, on the issue of a black person wanting that flag to hang over their house, I don't see it, because why would I, as a black person, want to support a flag that was going to keep me in slavery? And then we might say, well, it wasn't representing slavery to me. The South represented keeping their slaves and linking them with the free slaves. So it just reminds me, that's like the Jews carrying a swastika flag over their house when they were enslaved by Hitler.
Exactly.
So I have that question, blacks who want to keep that as a tradition.
And I do also.
Well, let me do this. I'm going to open it. If there are any African Americans out there that feel the flag should not come down, please give us a call and tell us why. 804-321-10. They feel that it should not come down, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Any African Americans out there that feel that it should not come down, please give us a call. We want to know what it is that you're thinking, because we are not, we just can't understand. Phone lines are open, 804-321-1010, our toll free number, 844-321-1010. I just can't even, I don't know anybody that African American think that it should not come down. And if I were to meet somebody or think that they want to fly the Confederate flag on their car or their if I see a black person, I think I'm just going to go up to look, help me to understand. Thank you, Wendell. We appreciate your comments.
I have I've lamented for some while the fact that since we've been free, and again I repeat, we ain't been free.
We haven't been free.
We ain't been free since 64, 50 years ago.
Prior well, that's to a which, mindset.
That, no, that's in relative terms. We were in apartheid prior to the Civil Rights Act signing of 64. And so since then, we've traded freedom for acceptance. And that might be what Wendell was experiencing in the military. Fools who would trade freedom to be accepted by folks who are his peers. And that kind of pressure exists in the military. I've been in the Army. I kind of know how that goes. I never seen that. But he's been stationed in the Deep South, so, you know, regional things, you know, show
okay.
up.
Okay, okay.
Well, you know, I kind of disagree with that when you say we're not free. There's nothing.
You and I agree. I don't believe it.
There's nothing in America we can't do, places we can't go, restaurants we can't go because we're black. We can't, any way we can go get an education. I consider that freedom to go where I please, to say what I want to say.
In relative terms.
You may not be accepted.
I'm free. People ain't free.
I'm free.
My people are free. Anytime your banks are still secretly defrauding you and your mortgages. Anytime,
well, they can do that to white people. I mean, I'm talking about freedom of
anytime
under the Constitution.
Well, if you can't, wait a minute now. Freedom comes in different forms, and if you're not economically free, you're screwed. And when you can't get a mortgage, which is the first and most logical opportunity to build individual wealth. The equity in your home.
Well, I think what he's saying, he's not accepting that. He's not accepting that he's not free.
Whether you accept it or not.
No.
Because I have my own home. I've seen lots of African Americans that were home.
You may be free.
Well, but before then, we couldn't do it as a people.
Manchester, yeah. The federal government just fined multi-mega-million dollars against SunTrust Mortgage for defrauding black people in their mortgages.
But that doesn't have anything to do with freedom, though.
We're not even mentioning the large insurance companies that restricted insurance to black folk. That's a known fact.
Come on.
But do you consider that as not as a...
They didn't do it to other ethnic groups.
My question is, do you think that's it may be racism, but it's not...
if you're not economically free,
racism,
I
mean, it's an economic bond. It's not an economic bond.
The system, the systemic form of
because
manipulation.
Because you have black people working for these companies too.
Yes, you do. You're going to have that by default.
You got black people chiefs of police that beat black people across the head. What the hell are we talking about here?
Is that freedom or racism? Well, you know, if you got black
racism, to me, is a suppression of freedom.
Yeah, okay, well, I tell you what, let's
institutionalize.
Let's continue the conversation.
Maybe that should be a topic for another time.
That should be a good topic.
We're going to go to Black Talk Radio commentary with our friend Scotty Reed.
In Charleston, South Carolina, they claimed 9 lives. As another black church is still smoldering, my primary anger is towards the racist, cowardly terrorists who are burning down places of worship. However, I am angry with President Obama, whose administration has failed to respond appropriately to these terrorist attacks that they have yet to call acts of terrorism. In 2010, the Obama administration, along with Congress, decided it would be a good idea to only assign one person in Homeland Security to track and analyze right-wing extremists within the United States. Instead of restoring the staff to the unit tracking racist white terrorists after the attack in Charleston, the president instead decided to focus on the liberal agenda of gun control and is now pushing legislation that would force groups like the Klan to reveal donors. Besides the slow process this legislative proposal would take, it would likely end up failing and should be seen as a smokescreen as thick as the smoke rising from burning churches. The president has the tools he needs to go after terrorists through the Patriot Act and the National Defense Authorization Act. The KKK, which is planning rallies in North and South Carolina, has been emboldened by the federal government's unwillingness to take on white racist-based terrorism. White nationalist groups are using these attacks to recruit new members and have said that Dylann Roof was on the right track. The black community needs more than renditions of Amazing Grace in response to these terrorist attacks from President Obama. In addition to my anger towards the U.S. government, I am also angry that members of these churches are not pulling ships to guard them. While they are forgiving terrorists for these attacks, perhaps they should be asking for the forgiveness of their children for not protecting their churches. It is evident that what Robert F. Williams said over 50 years ago is true today, and that there is no protection or help for black people coming from the federal government in the South, and that if they want a deterrent, they must create that deterrent for themselves. Perhaps it is good that he is not with us today, as I am positive that he would be ashamed of how passive and misguided black people have become in this day and age in the face of naked racist aggression. This has been Scotty Reed with your Black Talk Radio commentary. Visit us on the web at blacktalkradionetwork.com.
This is Tanya Free. If it's Monday, it's time for Let's Get Busy with your host, King Salim Kalfani, 4 to 6 p.m. here on the Heart and Soul of the City, WCLM 1450 AM. Kick off the week with KSK, Commonwealth Consultation, LLC, for two power-packed hours of news you can use, feature guests, cutting-edge commentary, and more. Let's Get Busy with King Salim Kalfani every Monday at 4.
WCLM, 1450 AM, Highland Springs, Richmond. The soul of the city is WCLM, 1450 AM.
Yes, our way out of our constriction. Gonna be freaking up and down the hang up alleyway. With the groove I only got, we shall all be moved. Ready or not, here we come. Getting down on the one which we believe.
Join the conversation. Phone lines are open right now. Give Tanya a call at 804-321-1010 in Central Virginia and 844-321-1010 toll free coast to coast. That's toll free 844-321-1010.
Okay, we're back. Pete, I'm going to get you give you time to jump in here on the conversation.
Okay.
And with regards to the Confederate flag, and what do you think we need to do, or do you think it'll come down, and address Wendell's comment with regards to blacks thinking it's okay? Have you met any black folks that think that the Confederate flag shouldn't come down?
No, I've never met any black folk that
think I haven't had any conversation with
that that way. However, I believe that there's more behind the Confederate flag that we need to address.
I agree.
Marty hit the nail on the head. There must be some type of truth and reconciliation, because until those things are addressed, everything else is just blinding smoke.
Yeah.
Well, I think that the flag, for one thing, has brought us to the table that, Finally. Right. We are at the table. People are listening. And the media, while we got the cameras and everything on, we need to take advantage or use it, you know, to our benefit to talk about more important issues as far as education, the economy. So people are at the table now, whereas before we weren't. We were just talking during the break. The flag will still be flying. There would not be a conversation about taking it down had it not been for, you know, the tragic death of the 9 people that were killed. Mm-hmm. So
you know what I like to see? I like to see white pastors and churches come out and support taking the flag down. And like Marty talked about reconciliation, that's what Star said, yes. Is that Christians, that's white Christians who believe that slavery was wrong,
yeah,
have to come out and say it. Why should we defend this thing when they should be the one kind of coming out and says, this is wrong, we agree. Where are their voices at, right? Maybe there's some out there. I haven't heard
Give
them.
Give us a call, 804-321-1010. Yeah. Our toll-free number, 844-321-1010, or text us at TanyaFree63975. That's a good point. Very good point.
When you've got politicians who are elected taking that kind of risk,
right.
You would think preachers would just sort of help them out.
Mm-hmm. Well, especially when our president gave a eulogy that was powerful and heartfelt. If you have not seen it, you definitely have to watch the whole entire thing. I mean, I had tissue. I'm like, oh, my goodness. I mean, he gave a powerful eulogy. And like I said, it was heartfelt. Yeah. You could relate to it. And what I like about it the most is the fact, I tell you what, let me play a snippet of what he said. And I want to comment on it.
Oh, but God works in mysterious ways. God has different ideas. He didn't know he was being used by God. Blinded by hatred, the alleged killer could not see the grace surrounding Reverend Pinckney and that Bible study group. The light of love that shone as they opened the church doors and invited a stranger to join in their prayer circle. The alleged killer could have never anticipated the way the families of the fallen would respond when they saw him in court in the midst of unspeakable grief with words of forgiveness. He couldn't imagine that. The alleged killer could not imagine how the city of Charleston, under the good and wise leadership of Mayor Riley, how the state of South Carolina, how the United States of America would respond not merely with revulsion at his evil act, but with big-hearted generosity, and more importantly, with a thoughtful introspection and self-examination that we so rarely see in public life. Blinded by hatred, he failed to comprehend what Reverend Pinckney so well understood. The power of God's grace.
Yes, sir.
Now, the media didn't know what to do with that because he was talking from a spiritual standpoint, inspirational standpoint, and talking about God. How many, you know, presidents would come out and actually just
give a sermon?
Actually, right, exactly.
It was a sermon.
They did not know what to do with that because when I watched the news right after he gave it, they started talking about the escapees, you know. I'm like, what is, and the only thing they could really speak about was the song he sung, Amazing Grace. That was wonderful, but the actual eulogy itself, along with that, powerful, actually powerful. And I think it sums up this whole thing as to how we got to this point, God's amazing grace, you know. Let me go to the phones right quick. Salim, how are you?
Well, beloved, how you doing? And I'm enjoying the discussion. I don't know what Wendell was talking about, but you No, he was entitled to that.
Maybe we put out a call. Well, we get somebody to call. We would be shocked.
Wow. Yeah, really. I mean, except for those, you know, they always find in North Carolina and somewhere else some ex-NAACP president that they take a million pictures of or something like that. But we need to be careful to work on the people who wear dress suits, business suits and skirts, who wear robes and make decisions, laws, policies, procedures, decisions that actually are so detrimental to us. And so let's use this massacre, this execution, as they did for Emmett Till and 55 and the four little girls. Mm-hmm. And what I have found is that I've had younger people and other people asking me what organizations, how you get in contact. So maybe this will inspire a generation to change this nation. And that's what we have to do with it. And I'm excited about the possibilities.
I think you're right, Salim, especially when we saw that young lady, Brittany Newsom, climbing that pole. You know, I think the young people got it, and they are the ones that will definitely lead the fight.
Yep, other than Marty Jewell, you know. Okay, thank you.
Tell everybody to listen to your show.
Oh, yeah, Mondays, 4 to 6 p.m., Let's Get Busy. We've got to do something now. 1450 AM WCLM.
Absolutely. Thank you, friend.
Thank you.
Appreciate
it. Good to hear from you, buddy.
I think, let's go back to the president. He had an excellent week. In addition to the eulogy that he gave, that I think if you did not get it, and if that did not touch your heart, something, in my opinion, is truly, truly wrong. Like I said, it just made me so proud, you know, to see him in that moment and to just keep it real and to just give credit where credit is due, Almighty God. Talking
curious.
About... Go ahead, Marty.
I'm curious. How do we sustain the effort of this conversation, this national conversation? Anybody got any idea? You know how this stuff happens, man. Something happens like this and it shocks the consciousness and people have plenty to say about it for a week, 3 weeks, a month.
Well, I
think
this is...
And before you know it at all...
I don't think this is the case this time, for the mere fact that I think all eyes are on, you know, governors and mayors and seeing politicians and seeing what they are going to do. I think this is very long-lasting because, like I said, it's like Pete was saying during the break, it has reached national attention. And it's up to us to keep it alive. If we allow it to die, then, you know, we shouldn't wait to another death before, you know, be emotional about it. And then, like you were getting ready to say, it dies. I think we have to be responsible in keeping it alive, especially if we have the attention of businesses like Walmart and other big businesses that have gotten involved. So it's up to us.
But then we got a mayor.
And especially you have young people.
But then we've got a mayor who 20 years ago did the same thing. When they were trying to put the Lee mural on the flood wall, he poo-pooed our community efforts opposing that.
Okay.
And came out just last week and said, the Confederate flag's no big deal.
Okay, what we do, then we protest. We protest, Marty. This is the time when I think protest would be effective.
Well, you're starting to answer my question. How do we sustain it when you got a fool like Jerry Oliver, former police chief who came here, who wanted to reinstitute the anti-loitering law, okay, in which three black men could stand on the corner and be subject to arrest by merely standing there aggregated on the corner. I went nose to nose with the guy, but that's the problem, and that's probably what our guy was talking about in the military. You got people coming from the North having no earthly idea.
And that's when we educate.
About the race relations in the South. Or from the West, having no idea how intense race relations are.
And that's why we're here today. To educate.
All right.
Because, well, like you said,
you're going to do your part.
Yes.
I'm simply
and you're going to do your part.
Well,
all of us sitting here, all of us here are going to do our part. And I think that's what we have to continue to do.
All right.
And also to what Gilbert just said, get in the churches involved. as well.
Good luck.
If Marty, come on there.
Good, hey, give me a break. Good luck.
Work with me. The president already said grace. If the president give a sermon, it's our duty to make sure that. And if you were going to,
that was his hand. He was waving.
Think about this. When I look at the people at the Mother Emmanuel Church and how faithful they were and how committed to faith and trusting God, and you have to be. If you go into a room and you tell somebody that just killed your loved one, you forgive them. That is faith beyond faith.
Powerful.
Yeah. That powerful faith. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think there should be. I know there are other churches out in the land that teach that same type of faith and ministry.
Sure.
That they get
and
together.
Sure.
Get together. Black and white. Not just black.
That's
black
right.
and white.
That's right.
We can make, like the president said, God work a mysterious way. Maybe this is God saying, okay, look, my people, come on now.
Yeah.
Don't let me stop preaching up here. Go ahead.
it's a known fact that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword.
Right.
And, actually and truthfully, Marty had mentioned truth and reconciliation. Well, to be very honest with you, the truth is already written. Mm. And if we simply follow that path, we could cure a lot of ills.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now, the problem persists in how do we get people to buy into that. Now,
that's the reconciliation
that's
part.
The reconciliation.
You got to reconcile yourself to that truth.
Absolutely.
And white folks know it.
But how do we get to that point?
But then they catch it. I think, listen to President Obama's eulogy of Reverend Pinckney, touched people and got, and I think it resonated with them.
Yeah, what was so powerful about that particular eulogy, or sermon, I call it, that he gave, was not what he said on the surface, but what he was saying beneath the words.
Right, exactly. Mm.
That's what touched people, and that's what made it so powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We're going to get to that. Glenn wants to hear our thoughts on marriage equality. We're going to get on that.
You know, the thing I'm thinking about, I think Martin Luther King or somebody said it, that the most segregated place on in America is Sunday morning.
11 o'clock.
At 11 o'clock.
Exactly.
And so you talk about all this love and unity, but that stuff starts in the church, works into the families, and goes down from generation to generation.
Right.
So if we don't have it there within the white churches and the black churches, we like Marty said, how do we continue this dialogue? Is that it's got to be bought from those people who hold the fire or the lamp up, you might say, for the people to walk in, the light.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we don't have those, getting those people at the table, saying this is what we have to do as a culture, as a society, and work to the common good. But if you don't have those people at the table, it's like, okay, we're working on our own, trying to work from the bottom to the top.
Mm-hmm.
It can happen, but it happens so much faster if you come from the top, those leaders, religious leaders, working for the common good, which is supposed to happen anyhow.
And also, too, our politicians.
Exactly.
Look how business is done in Washington. So divided. I mean, and they're fighting back and forth, and we allow it. That's even a more of an issue. Why do we allow? Why do we keep electing people and they go back to Washington, do nothing, or in a gridlock? Why do we keep doing that?
Because we keep paying them.
Well, no, because
we keep paying. They're getting the check.
Well, I tell you what. Hold that thought for a minute. Take a break.
We have a civil war going on right here today.
That goes back to.
Teacher. You're listening to AMFM 247, music you love from the 40s, 50s, and 60s. Best talk radio all day and every day.
Doc, you gotta give it to me straight.
All right.
Because I'm dying here. I mean, take a look at this letter from the IRS.
Oh, my.
This is killing me, Doc. I tell you, it's killing me.
Cheer up, my friend.
Huh?
The tax doctor is here. My diagnosis tells me that you're going to be just fine.
Really?
The tax doctor will not rest until we find you the best possible tax settlement.
Really, Doc?
Guaranteed.
If the IRS claims you owe them $10,000 or more in business or personal back taxes, call a tax doctor right now. We could save you up to 75% if you qualify. Guaranteed or you pay nothing. Call right now for free details.
800-918-7169. 800-918-7169. 800-918-7169. That's 800-918-7169.
Get boogie down, down on home ground. The boogie down, down on home ground. The boogie down, down on home ground. The boogie down, down on home ground. Let's groove tonight. Down, down. Share the spice of life. Down, down. And it's life tonight. We gonna groove tonight.
Join the conversation. Phone lines are open right now. Give Tanya a call at 804-321-1010 in Central Virginia and 844-321-1010 toll free coast to coast. That's toll free
844-321-1010. Hi, I'm Antoinette Bell, reporter for the Tanya Free and Friends radio show. Will you answer a question for me? In the last couple of weeks, there has been discussions to remove the Confederate flag from the state's property in several states. In addition, they are demanding to remove statues honoring Confederate leaders such as Robert E. Lee. What do you think, in addition to taking down the Confederate flag, do you think it is necessary to remove all Confederate landmarks?
No, I do not think that is necessary. No, I do not think it is necessary to remove all of the Confederate statues.
Why is that?
Because no matter what, it is part of our, it is part of Virginia's history. And like all other statues in other cities, these generals, they were part of Virginia history.
Even nationwide?
No, not nationwide. They're important to the history of Virginia. Just like in other states, they have statues that are that were important to their histories of their leaders.
So you don't agree with the Supreme Court decision to remove the Confederate flag in South Carolina because of what had happened in Charleston, South Carolina? This is what made this discussion to come about.
I agree that the flag should be removed and that the flag should be put in a museum because the young man that killed the 9 African blacks used the flag as as a symbol for his hatred of black people. Yes, I do think the flag should be removed. After all, it was not the Confederacy that won the war. So why are we putting their flag up?
Well, thank you, ma'am, for your time. And remember, you can hear your responses at the Tanya Free and Friends radio show Wednesdays at 2 p.m. Thank you.
I want to thank Antoinette Baylor for that roving correspondent. And that's one person that she didn't say she didn't support. She does. She thinks the flag should come down, but she didn't think the monument. So
that's why I was getting kind of frustrated with her. I was like, you're like 60-some years old. That's why I picked you. She was frustrating me. I was like, I got to cut this.
Okay. Well, that's one person. That's one person. Let me read the comments so we can move on to Obamacare. We'll talk about that for a minute. The South. Now, Jesse said the South lost and do not deserve the type of recognition. Suzanne said these symbols are a reminder of the South dark past. No. Hold on. Let me put my glasses on so I can see what the heck I'm reading. No pun intended. Canada said the symbol of hate can be removed, but the presence of bigotry cannot be removed by removing a statue. Okay. And Grace said, I've seen more Confederate flags on the back of trucks lately than ever before. Mm-hmm. Let's work on removing discrimination, not the symbol of discrimination. Mark said the whole flag and statue debate is a distraction as our voting rights are being diminished and cop killing our kids on the street. Okay. Trudy said you can take down every flag and every statue and black people will still be second class citizens even with a black president. Okay. Griff said, no, I have no problem with them. They encourage me to keep fighting. Okay, Griff, give us a call. We want to know if you're African American or not. Anonymous said, you have your Black History Month. Why can't we honor our history? Terrence said, major retailers are worried about image and making profits from the flag. Is it worth the consequence of being perceived as racist? Our friend Baye Kemboi said, the Confederate flag represents many things, cognitive dissonance, race, racial hate, a dub public, and a massive distraction from Americans' other problems. And longtime listener said, I don't give a damn about symbols. I care about the racists behind the symbols. Jesse Morris said, flag has to go as well as any state, local, or federal building, facilities, or parks with the names of Confederate traitors on them. And Stone Cold said, this is much to do about nothing. We can't choose our ancestors, and we don't have to agree to honor their contributors. Okay? So that's where we are with regards to the flag. We'll see what happens next week in South Carolina. Let's move on to one thing that has been also in the news. President Obama, like I said, had a real good week. We're going to talk about same-sex marriage now being legalized, and as well as talk about Obamacare first, which I want to talk about that for the mere fact that a lot of people do not understand what the Affordable Health Care Act is. And I'm going to call it Obamacare because President Obama has. So I am one that do not really understand. I know I pay for insurance, you know, that is expensive as all get out. But Jeff, you are an expert in it. So can you just give us a quick, you know, synopsis as to what Obamacare really is?
Oh, well, sure. Obamacare, as it is affectionately known, is principally the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. Not a lot of people know that, a lot of people know, but I'm not sure, maybe everyone knows that it's actually modeled after the healthcare system initiated by Mitt Romney back in Massachusetts. It's actually,
I didn't know that.
Actually, based on a Republican plan. But, you know,
so why were they fighting so hard to, because it had Obama's name, because of the president? Is that the reason?
Has been cited as you know, one of the reasons.
Wow!
Just because he introduced and you know it's
a political thing.
Yeah, pretty much. The Affordable Care Act actually takes the three components and puts them together. The principle real thing that they said was supposed to be the problem was the individual mandate that says, you know, everybody has to pay for it.
Right. That's where I got stuck. Right. Okay.
Because everything, you know, I think this system had been pretty much used for a long time, except it didn't have that mandate. And, you know, it was saying that healthy people or people that could actually afford insurance would wait until they got sick to go purchase insurance, which mm-hmm. would, you know, drive the cost up for everybody else who couldn't afford it.
Mm-hmm.
So by introducing the mandate part, they're saying, okay, you have to pay into the system, which pays for the subsidies that are going to
be
put into your taxes. You know,
it's a tax.
Sure. It's more tax. You know, well, the IRS governs that whole part of it. So, yeah, it's a tax. You call it what it is. But what it's done is it's made it more insurance more affordable for the middle class. Let me ask this question.
So the people that cannot afford, you have to be in a certain income bracket, correct?
To be able to qualify for the subsidies, yes.
Okay, that's the part that was throwing me. You have to be
100% to 400% of federal poverty level.
Okay, so those of us that do not fall in that category end up paying a whole lot more.
Yes. Well, if
graduates.
Yes,
or we have to be, or we being mandated to be a part of it.
No. Well, you have to. The only mandate itself is that you have to have insurance of some sort, or be found exempt. You know, if you qualify for the exemptions, then you.
So I do not. I don't have to go through healthcare. Whatever it's called.
No, you can.
Okay, I can get insurance outside of that.
You can go directly to the insurance company. You don't have to go through the Affordable Care Act marketplace.
Which way is cheaper?
How much do you make?
Okay, that's what it's based on. It's based on income. Yeah. Okay.
Let me read you a statement, a transcript of Dr. Bella, who is a former major in the U.S. Army, and I got with her, a doctor. She says, this is a transcript, we're going to be gifted with a health care plan we are forced to purchase and fine if we don't, which reportedly covers at least 10 million more people without adding a single new doctor, but provides for 16,000 new IRS agents who can pay them, taxpayers, written by a committee whose chairman says he doesn't understand it, passed by a Congress that didn't read it, but exempted themselves from it, and signed by a president who smokes. Same sentence. With funding administered by a Treasury chief who didn't pay his taxes.
Smoke, boy, what are you talking
about? I'm just reading it. I don't know. For which we will be taxed for 4 years before any benefits take effect by the government, which has already bankrupted Social Security and Medicare, all to be overseen by a Surgeon General who is a beast and financed by a country that's broke.
Okay.
I mean, you're talking about a new tax. You're talking about adding all these people to the healthcare system, not adding any new doctors, and a lot of doctors are actually getting out because what happens when you have all these people coming on to the when you go to a doctor's office right now, you go in, your doctor spends a little time with you, and if you're a Medicare patient, they pay you a little money. You'd be surprised how much that the doctors actually get for a Medicare or Medicaid patient. Very low. They haven't changed since 1950s. I think like $50.
Mm-hmm.
So when the doctor comes in, and he's taking on this, he has to spend less time with all these people that are coming. He won't have time to really talk to you because he has to see so many more patients.
I disagree with that because I know. I went to a doctor and he wasn't on the time clock, and I know I spent pretty good. Well, two of the doctors that
and you ain't on Medicaid.
That's the problem.
He's talking about Medicaid patients.
Right.
Okay. That is that would be different.
He got paid when he's talking to you. Yeah, he did.
Okay.
But I'm saying, you know, you don't get the same medical care, and
I agree with you there. Okay. If you're on Medicare, Medicaid, and private insurance. Now, let me say this. I think that I have no problem with Obamacare because I do feel that everybody should have insurance. I agree with that concept of it.
Do you think that others should pay for that?
Considering that I'm paying an arm and a leg, I'm a little.
The premiums have gone up,
heck yeah.
Especially for you.
Heck yeah.
And
I'll try to figure out why.
Because you got to pay for that.
I wish there was some kind of way we could change that.
Truth be told, healthcare costs is going up through the roof before Obamacare.
I agree with that too.
In an unsustainable way. If something had not happened,
You couldn't afford it.
Yeah, I agree with you 100% because now healthcare is, of course, it's like a business. Now the first thing they want to know when you go into the office is, do you have insurance?
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And then it depends on what type of insurance you have. You have Medicare, if you got, you know, this insurance, silver, gold, or whatever the case may be. And it's really unfortunate that determines the type of care you're going to get. Now, if you have an illness, they should treat your illness no different than, you know, somebody else that comes in. Sure. Regardless as to what type, in my opinion, what type of insurance you have. I'm sorry, Jeff, to cut
in. The subsidy is built into the statute so that because everybody is paying for it, you know, because you get the tax credit that are attached, because you have the option. Even if you make, you know, 100% within that range to 100 to 400% of federal poverty level, if you are outside of that range, then you can afford insurance.
Okay. Now talk about us that do not fall within that range.
That may not necessarily be a true statement, because with the cost of insurance, if you have a family, if you go outside of that plan, health insurance for a family is rather hefty.
Yes, sir. Where you
are. Yes, sir.
Along with your other daily, I'm not talking about extra expenses. I'm just talking about daily living expenses, such as a roof over your head, sure, which is mortgage.
Sure. Yes, sir.
Electricity and things of that nature. So, although I do understand the theology behind what you're saying,
okay,
but that's not necessarily a true statement.
Well, I guess in the majority of cases where they've you know, tested it, mm-hmm, and looked at the statistics, there are because you're able to get the same plan virtually or a version thereof or something similar to either inside or outside of the marketplace, you know, you have the option of which way you want to go with, mm-hmm, your family, and you can juxtapose and see which is going to be more cost effective, mm-hmm, okay, and then, you know, you make that decision. Either way,
you can choose.
Right. And you, the system, it's kind of self-perpetuating. It pays for itself because the individuals that don't qualify, you know, they're not fined. They're not taxed.
Who's not taxed?
The individuals that don't qualify.
We don't get fined. Let's say, for instance,
for the subsidy.
You're not fined. You get an exemption. Taxed because you paid for... The law requires you to have insurance.
Right.
The law doesn't require.
So that's a mandate. That's a mandate.
Right.
That is a mandate.
That's what I was asking earlier. That's a mandate.
Yes, ma'am. Right. Okay. That's a mandate. And if you don't get the insurance because you don't qualify for the mandate, then they're not going to hold you accountable because you don't qualify according to their criteria.
Right. Okay, I don't qualify for the portion of the subsidy.
Explain that again because I didn't get that.
Okay, hold it because we have to go to break. Kevin disagrees with the Supreme Court. The mandate is unconstitutional. That's what Kevin is saying. That's what we're trying to hash out right now. We're going to take a break and come back to that, okay?
Us while we pray for you. Every day we pray for you. Till the day we meet again. In my heart is where I keep you, friend. Memories give me the strength I need to proceed. Strength I need to believe. My thoughts big, I just can't define. Wish I could turn back the hands of time. Us in the six, shop for new clothes and kicks. You and me taking flicks. Making hits, stages they receive you on. Still can't believe you're gone. Give anything to hear half your breath. I know you're still living your life after death.
This is Coffee Black. Come and through to bring you the latest in sports, celebrity, and entertainment news. Here's The Sip this week. So last week I told y'all about Claudia getting fired from Atlanta Housewives. Well, it looks like her replacement may be Kim Fields, a.k.a. Regine. So at least she's a wife, but I don't know if I can handle two blondes on this show. And I'm sure NeNe ain't having it. So we all heard about Diddy's arrest for assaulting the UCLA coach, but this may affect his liquor license. Apparently, you can't have a felony and hold a liquor license. Who knew? Where is Johnny Cochran when you need him? And Rick Ross just needs hands laid on him. He was denied bail with kidnapping and assault charges. He'll be locked up until at least July 1st. Sometimes this brings out aggression in people. We'll saw y'all. I'm just saying. Check out more on my site, thesipwithcoffeeblack.com, and tune in next week to The Sip with Coffee Black. No sugar, no cream. Black coffee, no sugar, no cream.
That's the type of girl I need. The New Orleans Talk Network, now on your mobile device.
On your computer.
In your ear. And interactive. It's new. It's innovative. And it's on your mobile device.
Android.
iPhone. iPad. And on your computer.
Take us wherever you go.
Because we're interactive. 504-341-TALK. That's 504-341-8255.
Advertise with Tanya Free and Friends. Text the word advertise to 63975. That's 63975. Or give us a call at 844-321-1010. That's 844-321-1010.
Real Brother here. Play resumes. I wanted to invite the friends to join me for the Real Brother Radio Show. Weekdays from 6 to 9 p.m. on the Real Brother Radio Show Network. And you can always like us on the Real Brother Radio Show Facebook page. That's the Real Brother Radio Show on the Real Brother Radio Network.com. Because the truth has value. Oh, I like that.
Check out the Tanya Free and Friends Rewind. Every Thursday at 6 p.m. Eastern on the May We Help You Radio Network at MWHWRadio.com.
The conversation. Phone lines are open right now. Give Tanya a call at 804-321-1010 in Central Virginia and 844-321-1010 toll free coast to coast. That's toll free 844-321-1010.
During the break, we were beating up Jeff with regards to Obamacare. I think we agree with those that didn't have insurance and getting a subsidy. We agree on that. It's those of us that have insurance and how the premium has doubled. I think you were saying the same thing, Gilbert. Mm-hmm. And why, I, like I said, I don't mind paying a little extra, but when it doubles and then I got a huge deductible and then I got folks looking at me like, okay, I even went to had a situation appointment the other day. And I went to a hospital. They had the nerve to tell me they didn't accept this. I had to maintain myself. I'm like, okay, I'm paying X amount of dollars. You mean tell me you don't accept this? Or you got to go to such and such. I looked at them like,
Okay.
Yeah. Well, so help me to understand.
Well, okay. Individuals who make the choice to go through the marketplace or not go,
go ahead, I'll let you finish.
If you stay outside the marketplace, you know, it just depends really if you educate yourself on to the fact of whether your insurance company is participating with Affordable Care Act and with your plan, your particular plan or not. And, if you see a rise in your premium, open the roof. Open enrollment comes along, you might want to shop around.
Oh, what about those people that don't, I did that.
What are those people that don't not in groups, like individuals who have to go out and buy insurance?
Right.
Why would anybody do that?
Because you're not working for a company.
But like, you can find a group. You can always find a group.
But
if you know anything, if you get an independent agent, he'll find you a group.
Individuals, you don't have to be in a particular group. That's why it's the individual marketplace and the group. Now where the big argument is coming from is, like I say, the healthcare providers and the insurance companies who are saying, I have to buy this, and what if I don't think it's right?
But isn't it mandatory for us to have insurance, even if you, like I said, that are private and outside, that are not a part of the folks that have the subsidy? Don't we have to have insurance?
Before we left,
we talked about if all of us at this table do not have insurance, we would be fine, correct?
Yes, correct.
Okay, if we're going to be fine, that means we have to have whatever it is that's available.
Well, you do that or pay the fine. Either way.
Which one is cheaper? How much is the fine? I think, Antoinette, you were sharing how much the fine could be.
It depends on your income level.
Yeah, it's based on your income level. And it goes up incrementally. But
just give me based on your income level. Okay,
let's say you make 50 grand. What would the penalty be?
What's the percentage? Yeah, 10, 15, 20. What?
No, it's initially 2%.
2%. Okay, yeah, 2%. That answers that question then.
But that's only if you are in the lower end of the
scale.
Income level, the scale. It was $495, I believe, this year, and it's going up next year.
What, the cap is $495?
Yes.
One of my clients, when I do taxes during tax season, because she didn't have it for the whole year, but she was at the lower bracket, she had to pay like $107 or $114.
Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, in the beginning, it's just a small percentage of your income, 1% or 2%.
There is a point, I'm sure, in the scale of things, of income, that you can be self-insured, right? You can pay for your
own medical. But the thing is, when you go to the doctor, like I said, they want to know, first thing they want, before they even ask you your name, do you have insurance? That's the bottom line.
Right. And
let me say this. And if you do not have an insurance that they're recognized, because before I was able to get into the insurance, I had something and people didn't even recognize. I was too embarrassed to even present it because they would look at me like, what? You know what I'm trying to say?
Look this up. I have a breakdown of what she was asking for. If you're less than 9,000 income, you're zero. Mm-hmm. Between 9,500 and $37,695 penalty.
Okay.
If you're 50,000, it's 1,000. 75, 160, 1600, 100 on up, 2000. 200,000 is 4,700. But listen, the IRS will collect the penalty tax, a fact that no doubt further engaged those who hate Obamacare. But here's some of the good news, folks. The IRS will not have the power to charge you criminally or seize your assets if you refuse to pay. The IRS will only have the ability to sue you. And the most the IRS can collect from you if it wins the suit is 2 times the amount you owe.
Well, I suggest you pay.
If you want to thumb your nose at the penalty.
We're not even going that far.
Is this when you do your taxes on your own? Because I know where I work at, we take it all the mailing. So is this for people who doing their taxes and mailing it in on their own or e-filing it?
I don't know what this says right here. This is basically the penalties.
Because we take it that same day.
Okay.
Either way, when the IRS receives your tax return, if you have not checked the box that says you have insurance, they're going to take that portion that applies to your particular return, depending on where you fall at in the income.
And the Supreme Court said you can do it.
And if
the Supreme Court says something
twice.
Yes. So what? If the Supreme Court says it can do something, I mean, it's an extension of the government into our private lives. That's all it is.
I don't look at it that way.
Oh, really?
You're just saying that for the sake of argument, right?
That's the sake of argument. The government says you're going to pay more taxes and you're going to do what I say.
Yes.
You're already paying taxes.
Yes, or you will go to jail.
But the government doesn't have the right to get into our insurance. Just like, for instance,
You're supposed to have a seatbelt on, which you should. But should the government tell you should wear a seatbelt? Is it a broken? Are you hurting somebody else because you have a seatbelt on?
No, but
No. Alrighty. Listen, I'm asking you a question. Am I infringing upon your rights because I get in the seatbelt thing and I'm kind of like killed or whatever it may? But is that something that the government should say? You better have this seatbelt on. Am I hurting someone else by me not having a seatbelt?
Let's shift it. Talk about same-sex marriage then.
Should
the government be in your bedroom?
No.
Then why do you have a lot of politicians that's trying to make it a political issue?
Because there are people in the culture trying to make it an issue, and they're forcing upon the politicians to move and act on this way, and the other people that should be for traditional marriage are sitting down somewhere on the couch looking at it, seeing what's happening.
And you saying that they should be up in arms and raising hell about it, pushing back on gay people who want to marry.
Right, because you have a particular...
Because it's not defined as a marriage.
By whom?
According to, yeah.
Listen, let me share something with you. Every law that we have on the books should go back to some moral law that we live by.
Oh, should.
Yeah, should. Because everything was established on a moral law. I mean, if not, what's this established on? A non-moral law? Okay. The right to take on someone else's life and not to take someone else's life. That's based on a moral law.
Exactly.
This, our society is based on operating on some moral law. But if you have a law that says, okay, the moral law says it's marriage between a man and a woman, and the Supreme Court says, no, times have changed, culture has changed, we're going to change that moral law.
Morals have changed.
But you just said, you just gave the example that if you don't want to wear a seatbelt.
That's not a moral law, though.
Why not?
That's not a moral law.
Why is that? If it's an issue of public safety,
wearing a seatbelt is not a moral law.
If it's for
How can you define that as a moral law? Safety is one thing, but it's not a moral law. That's my right. Let me say something. The way God's kingdom is based on moral law, according to your definition.
Who you want to love as well. You should have any business in anybody's bedroom.
Well, I'm. This is my opinion.
That's what you're doing.
And this is one man's opinion. Everyone has the right to their opinion. I'm not saying that it's right. I'm not saying that it's wrong, because I don't judge anyone.
Right.
My opinion is... my opinion only.
Yeah, weird.
I don't believe in same-sex marriage, but that's my opinion. Am I judging it? No.
I'm not judging it. How do you feel about interracial marriage? Is that a moral law?
No. That's, if it's between a man and a woman, that's there's nothing in the Bible talks about race in the moral law. It says a man and a woman. When it says a man shall leave his father, father, mother, and cleave to his wife, God made man and woman. So how do we get this marriage defined off of when God says marriage is this way? How do we in the culture say no?
Because you have separation of church and state. That's why.
Right. Exactly. Wait a minute. And then you have people. But you have people that have different religious beliefs.
Can't change moral law.
What if it's okay for one religion to say, okay, we recognize same-sex marriage, but it doesn't.
That's between religions. And we have a state that's saying, we have a government that's saying, oh, look, we're going to change the Bible. We're going to change
We have a government that says, if I can use this term.
Go ahead.
I don't care what you do with your pee-pee. let me clean that up now. People forget that pee-pee stands for private parts.
Right.
But you cannot discriminate against people in the face of the law.
But let's talk about
the rights you attain to one... You have to take it to another.
Right.
You're not seeing
separation of church and state.
The Constitution provides for that. You are not seeing the spiritual implications of when a nation sins. The Bible says when a nation sins, God judges that nation. You can look at it all through history.
But that's the case. When you discriminate from a racial standpoint.
Our laws
against
are not
the people.
Holy Constitution provides based see, on
if you look at history
on the Bible.
If you look at history
our
through the
laws
Bible,
are not based on the Bible. Where you get that from?
Right. Your Constitution is not based on you what Constitution
Our laws are not based on the Bible.
Tell me which one is not then.
Our laws are based
on... Thou shalt not kill.
Our laws
Where did that come from?
Our laws that comes are from, based that comes on from, a set Leviticus. Of moral codes. Thank you. Yeah.
And what does this say in Leviticus? It is an abomination.
That's not where our system of government is based
on. He's saying, where is it in the law? Where is it in our Constitution? Where is that?
That's not, you know...
What, man,
Leviticus.
When Thomas Jefferson and the rest of the Constitutional Congress, they did not base it on biblical principles.
It is derived from morals.
They may have borrowed some language from it, but it's not solely based on that.
Okay, where does that come from?
That's common law. That's Magna Carta. Where did that come from? British.
Where the originality of that
same thing? Oh, let me ask you this.
Where does freedom come from? Freedom? Is that Constitution?
No.
Where did it come from?
That comes from the French Revolution. Oh, that whole concept of democracy.
Are you telling me that God didn't give us freedom? Oh, that the French Revolution gave us?
No, I'm not telling you that.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Well, okay, let me ask. Where does capital punishment come from?
The Bible.
Ideas
came from the Bible.
It came from the Old Testament.
Old Testament.
Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth.
2 for 2.
Well, I get that.
Which goes back even further. Okay. Hammurabi's code. Yes, sir.
That's right.
Okay. So, well, we have to continue this conversation.
Well, because I didn't know we were going to go get religious in there.
That's what you got. If you're going to discuss this stuff, you got to go back to the root
okay,
of this thing.
Okay. So you know what? The next time we have this conversation, I'm going to have a minister that can.
Are you looking at one? Right
oh,
here.
Okay. We didn't know that. All right. Okay.
Then. All right. I understand why.
Bring your Bible next time. Then. Yes, sir. Okay. As always, I thank God.
We're having all this trouble.
As always, I thank God. I agree with the Lord Jesus Christ for allowing us the opportunity to speak and hopefully heard. Thanks to our listening friends. Blessed to be every one of you. And of course, thanks to Marty, Pete, Jeff, Gilbert, Marcus. Also to Van was in the house. Antoinette, Coffee Black, Andre, El Bravador, Roosevelt, Mr. Free. I'm Tanya Free. Until next time, be free. Remember to live life with a purpose.
Joining us for this installment of Tanya Free and Friends Talk Radio. Don't forget, the conversation continues 24/7 at tanyafree.com. Keep up with the hottest topics of the day, post your comments, opinions, and more, all at tanyafree.com. On air, online, and on point. Views and opinions expressed by the guests do not necessarily reflect the views of the host and or this station. Tanya Free and Friends Radio is a production of Freedom Marketing, Inc. All rights reserved.